Okay, so in this video, I'm going to go over just quickly over how multimeters are, how they work, and the different modes on here, and some tips and tricks on how to use them and things to watch out for. Multimeters usually have similar forms in some ways. You have your main output screen, you have your function selection knob, you have the additional function buttons at the top, and you have your input and output ports for your probes. Now, multimeters in general have similar functions for the most part, but there's some multimeters that have specialty functions, and there's some cheaper multimeters that may only have a certain range of functions. Some multimeters are designed to be used within high calibration environments, so they're very accurate. Others are pretty general use. Some are designed for microelectronics, and some are designed for electricians working on high energy systems. It just really depends on what the multimeter is for. But in this case, these multimeters are very standard in terms of their functionality. In fact, they're a little bit nicer because, see here, one of their functionalities is measuring capacitance, which is not generally a standard function on normal multimeters. But the function wheel up here, you can see all these different options up here. So the first is off, obviously, turns the unit on and off. You have your voltage AC, voltage DC. Lows, it's a low impedance function which can help reduce readings of ghost voltage on things like circuits inside the walls and stuff like that. And that's something you have to worry about unless you're doing an electrical, like house wiring. Frequency measurement, a ohms or resistance measurement. This is a continuity tester. So this is what will sound the buzzer inside of it when the two probes are shorted together. You have your capacitance test, which measures capacitance. You have your AC amperage and AC milliamperage measurement. And then the DC component of that, both in amps and milliamps. And finally, a temperature gauge. Something that's really important that you need to keep in mind when using these is the inputs here. Some multimeters only have two inputs, some have three, some have four. But they're usually pretty standard in what they do. For example, this has three inputs. You have your common, which is ground. You have your voltage, and you can see here on this probe in particular, you have all these little symbols, and these are the symbols that match up with these functions on this wheel. So if you want to use one of these functions that have, like for example, capacitance, you would have to put the probe in this port here, which has the capacitance symbol here. Same is true for volts and resistance and all that. The other probe here, or the other port, is for amperage measurement, which will measure current. And this is kind of a safety point. When you're dealing with multimeters, it's generally a good idea to always check before you turn it on, before you even use it, to make sure that you don't have a probe plugged into here. And so there may be two ports, maybe one for milliamps and one for amps. This has them both combined into one. Either way, you want to make sure that your probe is not plugged in to this port unless you are trying to measure current. The reason is that if you switch this over to voltage, for example, and stick this probe into something that has a lot of energy behind it, for example, inside of this multimeter, it doesn't care that it's on voltage because this circuit in here is an almost direct short between this probe and this probe. So best case scenario is that it doesn't measure anything on here because it's the circuit for the voltage measurement is not actually connected. Worst case is that you plug this in and a fuse will pop inside of here because it'll try and pass a huge amount of current. On really cheap multimeters, it's dangerous because if they don't have fuses, they could literally explode. So generally a good rule of thumb before you even start working with the multimeter, what I do usually is check the ports, make sure there's nothing plugged into this. Leave it plugged into that. You'll want to move the ground one at all. That's going to stay there forever. But before you even turn it on, just make sure that plug is empty so you won't accidentally short out your multimeter. So let's say I want to measure DC volts. So let's switch over to the DC volt range. And this is an auto-ranging meter, which means that it's going to automatically change the range inside of here to best suit the measurement you're trying to work with. So if you, right now it's on millivolts, but if you're working with something that has, you know, volts, it would be higher than let's say 600 millivolts, or for example, it'll switch over from using millivolts to volts. So certain modes of this, as you might have gathered, are useful for certain types of devices. So I've grabbed a few random stuff off the shelf, a random capacitor and a 220 ohm resistor. So I can, for example, switch it over to resistance mode, use my probes and probe between the two ends of the resistor here, and you'll see 219.6. So that's pretty close. It should be ideally 220, but it's still within spec. They have a little bit of wiggle room for what's accepted. Next is the capacitor. So we'd switched over to capacitance. For measuring capacitors, you want to measure them out of circuit. So that's a good idea for this one. I have no clue what this one is, so we'll figure it out together. Just probe between the two rails here. So that's probably a 100 nanofarad capacitor. So that's sort of a limitation of this particular multimeter, is it's not able to measure nanofarads. It's only able to measure in microfarads. So that gets to be kind of an issue when you get to really small capacitors, less than 100 nanofarads. But for anything larger than that, this will probably be okay. One bummer of this, though, it does not have a diode mode. And the diode mode is used to measure across diodes like this to read their forward voltage drop. Unfortunately, this meter does not have that. It only has a continuity mode, which means that if you put this across a diode either direction, it's not going to register any kind of input on the meter there. It will only do the continuity. So if you're testing something in a circuit, for example, and weren't sure if it was connected to another device, you could use this and probe around in your circuit until you find something that is directly shorted to each other. And because this meter is rated for electrician use, it gives it away right here because of the low impedance mode. What you could do is safely measure the wall current. So safety is a relative term in this case. You still want to be careful because it is still live current, but the safety of this meter is fine in terms of its functionality. So I have it set to voltage AC. And make sure that it's not in the amp mode, because if you plug this in, what's in the amp mode, it's going to be a direct short through this meter and most likely break the fuse. But if you have a cheaper meter, it's not as well made, it could actually catch on fire and explode in your hands. So just make sure that you have it set to volt mode. So voltage AC, I'm going to take my two probes, hold them by the plastic, stick them into the outlet. So 119.7 volts. That's good enough. You need to make sure that, of course, this is on volts AC, and you need to know what kind of signal you're working with. So, for example, I'm going to switch this to volts DC, do the same thing. Check that out. 143 millivolts. It's nothing. So if you had this set to the wrong mode and you read this, you might think, oh, there's the circuit's dead. Let's switch back to AC mode. Oops. Yeah. Always double check your meter settings.